Very good morning, everybody. So today's lecture is on etiology of malocclusion, general factors, and the next lecture will be on local factors. So basically, in this lecture, we'll classify the etiological factors by different authors and also describe each of the factors in detail. So when we talk about etiology of malocclusion, that means we are going to talk about the causes which are leading to different types of malocclusion. And remember, recognizing and then eliminating these causes is an important part of our treatment, which makes sure that whatever we achieve as our treatment result remains stable. So there are various systems of classification proposed by different authors. So just to quote a few, according to White and Gardner's classification, he's classified it according to denture-based abnormalities, pre-eruption and post-eruption abnormalities. Salzman has categorized it as prenatal, postnatal, functional and environmental, whereas Moyers has classified it according to heredity, trauma, habits, diseases, malnutrition and developmental defects of unknown origin. So moving on to Graeber's classification, who has broadly classified it into general and local factors. That means the way our lecture is going to be depending upon our Graeber's classification. So the general factors will include heredity, congenital environment, predisposing metabolic climate and disease, dietary problems, abnormal pressure habits and functional aberrations, posture, trauma and accidents. Whereas local factors will be, that means which will affect locally, but they'll have a local effect on a particular area only rather than having a general effect on the entire body. So the local factors will be anomalies of number, tooth size, tooth shape, abnormal labial frenum, premature loss of any tooth or prolonged retention of any primary tooth, delayed eruption of permanent teeth, abnormal eruptive path, ankylosis, dental caries and improper dental restorations. So we start with the general factors, the first one being hereditary or genetic. Remember, it is one of the chief causes of malocclusion, that particular malocclusion is running in your genes. Okay, so these are some things for which our family history becomes extremely important in your case history recording, and we need to inform the patient that this is running in your genes, so we cannot really correct it to that extent. A typical example of your genetic malocclusion is your Habsburg jaw. We have already covered this in the growth of mandible. So this refers to a prognathic mandible which has been running in a German royal family, hence it has got a very, very strong genetic character. So a class 3 malocclusion and also a long face, these two are something which are very, very strong genetic characters. So whenever you see such a patient walking into your clinic, the first thing you need to confirm is family history. So that confirms that it is genetic in origin, and 90% of the cases it will be genetic in origin. That means it is difficult for us to meddle with it, because we can only change the environmental factors, not the genetic factors as an orthodontist. So hereditary also plays an important role in various factors. As we know, class 3, long face, also tooth size, the tooth number, tooth shape and even arch length. So in other words, the crowding and spacing of dentition is also can be due to hereditary or genetic factors. Apart from that, various other malocclusions as mentioned here. Clinical implications, as I already told you, greater the genetic component, the worse the prognosis for a successful outcome by means of orthodontic intervention. Hence, the moment we confirm a family history of any genetic malocclusion, we need to inform the patient prior to starting the treatment that the prognosis might not be that great, and we need an informed, written, signed consent by the patient. Next, we move on to congenital factors. These are referring to certain malformations that are seen at birth which will cause malocclusion. It can be single gene abnormality, chromosomal disorders, multifactorial disorders, disorders caused by teratogens or any unknown etiology. Most commonly, as an orthodontist, we are going to encounter patients with cleft lip and palate. We work in that Cooper's wheel along with various other teams to help render services to a cleft lip and palate patient. So we must know the features a cleft lip palate patient will present with. So of course there are going to be cross bites, the entire maxilla, since there is a cleft there in the middle of the palate, the growth of the maxilla will be constrained in all the three planes, be it vertical, transverse or sagittal. So it is collapsed and contained within the mandible. So there will be a cross bite, which can be, depending upon different situations, it can go into different extents. Just an anterior, posterior or a complete cross bite. Mandible will be in front, concave profile, class 3 patient with a maxillary retronathism. And of course, the extent of your cleft can also vary. It can extend into the nose. It can be bilateral, unilateral. That will depend upon the genetic defect which has been prevailing in the patient. And of course, there are various other dental anomalies because there is no bone, no teeth. Sometimes supernumerary teeth, ectopic eruption of teeth, and you need grafting to cover the gap or the cleft which might be present in the palate. So there can be different ways a cleft lip palate patient can present, and hence you will have to deal with each patient differently. Apart from that, there can be other syndromes like Peary-Robin syndrome, which has got a tetra to present with a cleft palate, along with that micronathia and glossoptosis. So the tongue keeps falling back and they have a very high chances of respiratory obstruction being caused because of the tongue falling back onto the airway. Down syndrome will be having the following features: macroglossia, hyperplasia of maxilla, delayed tooth eruption, partial anodontia, enamel hyperplasia. There can also be a cleft lip or palate. Hence, dealing with cleft lip and palate as an orthodontist is very, very important part for us to know. Then there can be hemifacial microsomia, where both, as you can see, half side of the face, look at the soft tissue, or you can even look at the underlying hard tissue will be affected. Then there can be various disorders by the teratogens, which are caused by certain chemicals to which, if the female is exposed during pregnancy, they can cause certain malocclusions. So these are the ones I have noted down for you in alphabetical order. So if you can see, most of them are actually causing cleft lip and palate. So we move on to the environmental factors, which can be categorized into prenatal and postnatal depending upon when they are affecting. So we start with prenatal. Prenatal, basically any abnormal posture of the fetus causing pressure in a particular part can impair growth of that particular jaw or area. And generally we expect that catch-up growth will take place the moment the pressure is released. Then of course our German measles, it's again a droplet infection. This can also lead to blindness, deafness and cardiovascular abnormalities, even enamel hyperplasia and delayed eruption of decidus teeth for us to be concerned as a dentist. Postnatally, this is not very relevant now, but earlier there used to be a forceps delivery when a fetus, a baby will be delivered using forceps, and there were very high chances to injure the joint, the TMJ, with which we'll hold and take out the baby. So if that happens, then the joint development or the bone development on that side will not happen because of the injury taking place at that condyle. Childhood fractures, it is the thinnest part, that means the condylar neck, which is most prone to be hit and have a fracture. But most of them will generally recover in an early age and grow normally. But sometimes if the soft tissue is also injured, then please go back to the growth theories, functional matrix theory. If soft tissue is injured, there is scarring, then it's matrix, the periosteal matrix, skeletal unit, everything is related. So even the bone of that side will not grow. So there'll be an asymmetric growth of the mandible. You can look at this patient. So the entire mandible looks deviated. The face will be grown in a deviated manner with one side of the mandible not growing at all and the other side growing. And hence then the chin will be deviated to one side. So you see facial asymmetry because of a small condylar neck fracture, which might have gone unnoticed in childhood. Then of course, muscular trauma also, depending upon the same functional matrix theory, if there is a muscle which gets injured early in life and it is not healing appropriately, then the skeletal unit attached to it, its growth will also be affected. So again, both excessive muscular contraction or decreased muscular tonicity, both are going to have adverse effect on the bones attached to it. Then we move on to predisposing metabolic climate and disease. So we have endocrine imbalance, metabolic disturbances, and infectious diseases. Starting with endocrine imbalance, hypopituitarism, I expect all of you to already know it because of your physiology classes. But just for a recap, I have put in important dental implications here for you to memorize. So hypopituitarism or dwarfism will lead to retarded growth of everything, because there is a decrease in the growth of the pituitary hormones there. So everything is delayed and decreased. Whereas hyperpituitarism, everything will be more accelerated growth, enlarged tongue, the cortical bone is also more, it is thickened, hypercementosis, so the reverse effects if you see. So these patients will typically be class 3 skeletally. If you look at it, this is how they will present. Hypothyroidism, again, everything is decreased, growth retardation, decreased vertical growth, decreased cranial base growth, delayed eruption. And hyperthyroidism will have a slightly opposite effect, where everything is increased. Hypoparathyroidism would lead to retarded eruption, early exfoliation, and enamel defects, whereas hyperparathyroidism will have disappearance of lamina dura. This is very, very important, which you are supposed to appreciate in a cephalogram or IOP if taken, and hence there'll be mobility of teeth also. If you look at the infectious diseases, I've broadly put the important ones here. Congenital syphilis, they have a very, very peculiar impact onto the dentition. Peck-shaped lateral incisor, mulberry molars, enamel hypoplasia, delayed eruption, underdeveloped maxilla, narrow maxillary arch. Osteomyelitis will have a bone response which will be altered because of the bone matrix being altered, and hence as an orthodontist we have to be very careful, note down the medical history, what medication the patient is under, and alter it accordingly depending upon our appointments. Tuberculosis will have a generalized stunted growth and hence delayed eruption of teeth. Mumps will be having a rapid enlargement of salivary glands. And if the mother is infected during pregnancy, that means it will have a teratogenic effect causing dental hypoplasia and retarded eruption of teeth. Rubella will lead to retarded eruption of teeth, dental hypoplasia, congenital malformations, again cleft lip and palate. So the dietary problems, if you see, again most of them are leading to cleft lip and palate. And then we follow protein deficiency, vitamin A deficiency. So all of us know about these deficiency syndromes, vitamin B complex deficiency. I've just noted down the important factors which will relate to the oral cavity over here. So vitamin C deficiency, that means all the factors, all the features of scurvy will be there. Vitamin D, all the features of rickets will be there. And hypovitaminosis D will lead to poorly calcified teeth, decalcification of bones, and increased osteoclastic activity. Then we move on to abnormal pressure habits and functional aberrations. So anything which is causing abnormal pressure in the oral cavity, which can be abnormal position of the tongue or some particular habit, be it thumb and finger sucking, is going to alter your buccinator mechanism, the normal balance of the dentition and the surrounding musculature, and hence it will lead to malocclusion. Posture, again, a particular posture, suppose you are stooping with chin on the chest, that means this particular posture, if it is kept for a very long period of time, maybe more than 6 hours, it is going to lead to a continuous pressure and alter the growth of the bone also. So this is also related to your functional matrix theory. So just for an example, you have your Milwaukee braces, which are actually given in the treatment of scoliosis, which holds the head in an extended position. But this constant pressure on the mandible will have adverse effects on the growth of mandible also. Similarly, you see the plaster cuts on the below picture. which is used to stabilize cervical vertebrae, can also produce similar effects. So something used for something can also have its adverse effects because it is being given at a growing age. So then, if you look at the profits classification, I have put this here so that your concepts become a little clearer. The previous one was Graber's, and now we are coming into profits classification of etiology of malocclusion, who has categorized it into specific causes, genetic influences, and environmental influences. So we move on to these. So basically, the dentition is not moving in the oral cavity normally because the forces which are acting outside of the dentition, that means your lips and cheeks, that forces are equivalent to the forces acting inside of the dentition, that means the tongue. So the forces inside tongue and the forces outside your cheeks and lips are in an equilibrium, making sure your teeth are not moving. So if you want the teeth to move, we have to disturb this equilibrium theory. And if we don't want the teeth to move, we have to make sure that the equilibrium is maintained. So your equilibrium can be lost because of habits, thumb sucking, tongue going down, altered position, extra force of thumb being added on the inside of the dentition, which makes the teeth move abnormally, leading to a malocclusion. So hence, we have to be very careful of how our equilibrium theory is being maintained and plan whether we want to disturb it for our own benefit, or we have to make sure that it does not get disturbed. So basically, primary factors which help in maintaining this equilibrium in the oral cavity are intrinsic factors of your tongue inside of the dentition, lips outside. Then extrinsic forces can be habits which the patient can have, and sometimes we have to remove them because they cause disturbance in the equilibrium. And orthodontic appliances, where we actually want to disturb this equilibrium so that we can make sure the teeth move. Then the natural forces from dental occlusion, again, this can be more in few people, and the force of mastication can be less in few. And forces from periodontal membrane, which are very, very important, which leads to active stabilization and maintaining the teeth in the position they are. Hence, if your dentition is periodontally compromised, they start moving even if the forces outside and inside of the dentition are maintaining equilibrium. So ultimately, it's the periodontal membrane which decides whether the teeth will be moving or not. So we start with tongue versus lip. So if you can look at this picture, the forces inside, that is the tongue, are actually much more than the forces outside of the dentition. But still, under normal circumstances, your teeth are expected to be in equilibrium. They do not move, despite of the fact that tongue is the strongest muscle. That is because of your periodontal force, that means your active stabilization by the periodontium, which adds up to the forces acting outside of the dentition and make sure your teeth do not move. But if you have an altered tongue position because of any habit, or your high lip position, high lip line, then again there can be a loss of equilibrium between these two musculatures, and it can make your dentition move in an abnormal way. Extrinsic forces, as I told you, can be the habits or your appliances. Of course, the effect will be evident if your forces are acting for more than 6 hours. So even if you're given any removable appliance, the effect is seen only if you wear it for more than 6 hours, be it elastics or any removable appliance. If you don't wear it continuously for more than 6 hours, it is a waste. It will not be able to disturb the equilibrium. And on the other hand, if you are having some particular abnormal oral habit, if you're not repeating that habit for more than 6 hours continuously, it will not have a deleterious effect and it will not be able to disturb your equilibrium theory. Forces from dental occlusion, again, this is the basic occlusion. These forces are the ones which are affecting mostly in the vertical plane. So it is going to lead to extrusion of your molar teeth and also cause a backward movement of your mandibles. All the effects of the forces of dental occlusion will generally be in vertical plane. Then we move on to forces from the periodontal membrane, which I already mentioned is the one which is very, very important, which is termed as active stabilization, which makes sure that even if the forces inside, that means tongue, is more than the forces acting outside of the dentition, that means your lips and the cheeks, still your teeth stay where they are. That's because of the forces which are acting in the periodontal membrane. This is termed as active active stabilization. If this decreases, then it leads to periodontally compromised teeth, uncontrolled movement happening in the dentition. And if such a patient wants orthodontic treatment, then the control of tooth movement becomes all the more difficult. Yes, so that's the end of the lecture. So please be ready for a short quiz after this. Thank you, everybody. Stay safe and keep reading.